angels waging war in the unseen realm. Global events fulfilling biblical prophecy. Eternal life. What lies beyond mortality? From analyzing the paranormal from a biblical worldview to the discussion of cutting-edge science and technology, conspiracy, discovery, special investigative reports. Unafraid to explore the challenging issues facing humanity, welcome to another edition of Skywatch TV.
If you're a Christian and you've been baptized, you have been exorcised. Welcome to Skywatch TV. I'm Derek Gilbert, in studio with my wife and my best friend, Sharon K. Gilbert.
Hi, honey.
And the author of a couple of very important books. He's the executive director of Luther Academy and professor of missiology and an international missions specialist at Concordia Theological Seminary. The author of two books we recommend for your reference shelf, I Am Not Afraid, Demon Possession and Spiritual Warfare, and Afraid, Demon Possession and Spiritual Warfare in America. Reverend Dr. Robert Bennett. Robert,
thank
welcome back.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be back.
One of the elements from your books that really caught me off guard is the idea that we as Christians often perform the rite of exorcism without even realizing it. Baptism, singing hymns, certain prayers. You mentioned in our last program things like a house blessing has an exorcistic function. Are we really engaging in spiritual warfare without knowing it?
Well, I think we are. I think we have to take a step back and say, okay, what is exorcism? Because generally, I think when we think of exorcism, we have that Hollywood understanding that this person, okay, there's a person who the demon has taken over, and now we have to somehow, through ritual or whatever the case is, remove that demon from that individual. And that's true, but it's also very limited in our understanding. If we understand that there are principalities and powers and the devil is a lion who's roaring, seeking to devour us, that means that we're constantly engaged in spiritual battles throughout our lives. Maybe not as drastic as the circumstance with somebody who's actually demon-possessed, but a large percentage of people, if they're honest with you, have a lot of spiritual oppression, mm-hmm. where they have difficulties in various ways. And just the general life, I mean, all of us are capable of some of the most horrific things, and the devil's really good at kind of pushing our buttons, mm-hmm. and moving us along. So if we look at exorcism as simply, as the word is meant to be, the word is ekbalo in the Greek, it simply means to cast out, to move away. And when we tie that to things like traditional things that we've done in churches ever since we've been in churches, things like baptism. If you understand that baptism has a promise to it, that we die with Christ, that we're raised with Christ, there's a promise that automatically takes away the lie of Satan and casts Satan away. Mm-hmm. You know, Satan, you have no power over because I've died with Christ, I'm risen with Christ, I am in Christ. There's nothing that you can do to me. And I think the Peter verse that deals with the lion actually ends in that way. You know, even though we're going to face these hardships, there's nothing to worry about because the Lord will sustain us, renew us, and likewise. And then the same thing goes for simply gospel reading the Bible. See, I come from a theological perspective that puts a really heavy emphasis on the personal attachment of Jesus to the gifts that he's promised to provide. So for baptism, for me, I would say, in addition to those promises that we've just spoken of from Romans, for instance, that Jesus is literally there in the midst of that baptism. Mm-hmm. That Jesus is literally there in the reading of those scriptures. It's not simply an inerrant historical word of God, but the Holy Spirit and Jesus is actually connected to that word. And then when you have Christian hymns that actually are hymns that have scripture in them, that actually have a content, and really all good hymns really should simply be sermons. You should be able to take a hymn and read it out loud, and it should be a doctrinally pure scriptural sermon.
Amen. Thank you so much for saying that. I have been saying that for years.
Well, I was telling you before the program that one of the things that Sharon and I have been disturbed by in churches that are trying to reach out to the seeker-friendly is the use of these praise and worship songs that are essentially
It's
pretty music, but if you change the word Jesus for boyfriend, you could play it on adult contemporary radio.
You wonder who it's talking about.
Exactly.
And actually, in the Afraid book, I take one particular hymnal, but a lot of the hymns you'll find in other hymnals as well. I take one from my particular denominational use, but a lot of those hymns are hymns you'll find in a Methodist hymnal or a Baptist hymnal or whatever. And it's interesting, I actually lay them out. I've got about 70 that I find out in my own particular hymnal, and I mentioned in the book there's probably many other ones that are exorcistic in nature. The hymns that talk about Satan, his power is just a facade. It's meant to scare us, but he's judged the deed it's done.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have a whole list of the hymns in there. So we start thinking about hymns. When you point this out to people, they say, oh, I see it here in this particular verse or stanza of the hymn. I just never thought of it that way before. In the first book, I go through and I look at all the exorcistic texts of all of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And when you lay them all out, most people are surprised there's that many. The problem I would find with preaching these days is those texts come up over and over again, especially if you belong to a church that uses any type of lectionary or anything like mm-hmm. that. Those texts come up over and over and over again, but rarely do you hear the preacher preach about that aspect of the text. They'll deal with another part of the text, for instance. Like, for instance, the Syrophoenician woman who comes and, you have the whole story of, well, even the dogs eat the scraps mm-hmm. that fall from the table. Well, the whole point of that text is she's there because her child is demon-possessed.
Right.
But rarely do you hear the sermon preached in that direction when you have that. So it's interesting. I picked this up in Madagascar when I was watching what they did. And an exorcism for them is simply prayer, confession of sins, singing of hymns, various scriptural readings with sermons attached to them. The Lord's Prayer, and for those who recite the Lord's Prayer and use the Lord's Prayer in their worship, the Lord's Prayer is an exorcistic prayer. I mean, the huh. end of that prayer is deliver us from, generally we say deliver us from evil.
Uh-huh.
But the actual Greek is deliver us from the evil one.
Yes,
yes.
So it's very specific in that way. So the Lord's Prayer is an exorcistic prayer. So in essence, if you look at what an exorcism ritual would look like in that particular context, or if you understand Jesus' presence and where Jesus is, Satan, cannot stand. We're undergoing exorcisms, those of us who attend church and read our scriptures, and so we're undergoing these things all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do that when I teach sometimes at a church. I'll just walk in, I won't say any of these things. I'll say, who here has had an exorcism before? And rarely anybody's going to raise their hand, except for some people, they'll say, oh, wait, I was baptized. The people who get it.
Uh-huh.
But then after I go through this, I said, no. You've had exorcisms over and over and over again your entire life, and you just simply never recognized it.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason you never recognized it is because the pastors and the leaders in the church didn't recognize it either, and they didn't teach it as it is. But when you start teaching and you go back and you look at the hymns, you go, oh, wait a minute, this is telling Satan to get lost. Or this is showing that Satan has no power over me, or the various texts of the readings. It just sticks right out in your face.
Now, the format that you just described, the people in Madagascar use for an exorcism, I spent a number of years attending Lutheran church on a regular basis, and that's very much like the liturgy in the Lutheran church.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it's also very much like the liturgy contained in the Roman Catholic Mass. So every week you're going through a standard format.
Mm-hmm.
As we talked before the program, I still remember some of the liturgistic call and response from the Lutheran hymnal. There was a movie from some years back, Fright Night, where a teenager discovers that his next door neighbor's a vampire, and he's got to go in there.
Too.
Yes, yes.
The original was better.
Yeah. The original much better. Yeah, Roddy Piper as the or not Roddy Piper, Roddy McDowell.
Yeah.
Roddy Piper. Anyway, comes in with a cross.
Roddy Piper might have been good too.
Comes in and out of bubblegum, though.
Yeah, that's right. He comes in with the cross to confront the vampire, and the vampire says, "You fool! That only works if you believe in it." Is that essentially the problem that we run into in the church setting, that we are so used to the routine that we don't really invest it with any faith or belief. We're just speaking a set of words because this is what we do on Sunday morning, and I can just kind of mentally check out, sing the response at the appropriate time, participate in the confession of faith when we have the group confession of faith, say the Lord's Prayer at the same time as everybody else, and just, you know, when things are done, then I can go home and continue my life as I've been living it.
Yes and no. Let me just deal with the fact of going through that process. While it's true you might be disengaged in the midst of that, and there's a problem with that, and that's what I want to get to my second
point. Right.
Nevertheless, you're still there in the place where the Lord has promised to be for you. In that word that's being read, you're still attaching yourself to that, even if you're somewhat disconnected. So it's still a good thing for you.
Mm-hmm.
The downside of that is you're going through this process, but without having an understanding, without thinking through these things, it's really opening you up to the lies of the devil. See, the lies of the devil is generally how Christians and others are affected. Generally, they're not demon-possessed and things, but they start to buy into the lies of the devil. Whereas if they knew their scripture, they knew what they were saying, they knew what these things meant, they knew what these hymns meant, every week it would be a clarification for them that those lies that they hear in the media, the lies they hear in their own minds and their own thoughts are not true. That in spite of what they're dealing with on this particular day, Christ died for them. In spite of the struggles they're facing, they are baptized children of God. He's promised to never leave them, never forsake them, Matthew 28, for instance. So I'd say there's still a benefit of being there, but what you're missing is all of that reinforcement for your daily life. So it doesn't change the fact that Jesus is still promising to be there, but it also doesn't help you insulate you from the lies of Satan that are all around you.
Mm. The lies of Satan are really going after kids right now. Mm-hmm. We've all seen stories about kids that are cutting themselves,
yep,
who are getting involved in creepypasta, believing in Slender Man, things like that. Did you run across any of that when you were collecting your stories for the books?
I didn't run across any of those particular stories. I do have a very chilling story in the book of two children, but they weren't involved in those things. It was a separate issue. But we do see that in a society where there is no truth anymore, where you can have this mixture of various spiritual ideas, all that is confusion. And so most children are not being brought up by their parents anymore in the faith. They're learning the faith how they want to perceive it through media, various media forms, whether it be TV or the internet or video games. There's a whole section in the book on someone who becomes addicted to a video game and the spiritual, mm-hmm, aspect of that. So basically children are starting to parent themselves with the material that's out there, and without having a biblical format and understanding of knowing who Jesus is. You know, the old days when we went to Sunday school, we learned the biblical stories, and they're missing all that. So they're completely open to all of these lies, and they're looking for something real in their lives, and they find the real bad stuff.
How does that manifest in the lives of Christians then, in terms of engaging in practices or beliefs that open doors or gateways for demonic oppression or possession? And I guess a follow-up question to that would be, is it possible for a Christian to be demonically possessed?
Okay, that's a good one. We'll hold off on that. You can ask me after the first one. The first one was what, though?
Well, just how is this sort of syncretistic,
sure,
mishmash of beliefs? How is it manifesting in things? What are we doing as Christians that is opening doorways?
Probably more things that we could even begin to talk about. In the book, for instance, I have a couple of different examples. One was I was on vacation with my family 1 year up in the mountains of Tucson, Arizona. Beautiful, beautiful place.
Mm-hmm.
And at this particular resort, they would have a Native American medicine man come, and he would put together a little morning blessing as the sun is rising for the people. And most people there, I talked to some of them after the fact, they're Christian people. They thought this was a great cultural thing. They're in the mountains of Arizona, and really, I go through the book and I analyze it. What the man was doing is he was running them through a way of finding their own ancestral spirits, and trying to do an exorcism to cast the bad spirits away from them, and they were burning the sage and they're saying the different prayers and so forth. And the people had no idea what they were doing. But that's what they were doing. But if they were looking at it in a spiritual way, they would have figured it out. But they just thought it was a cultural thing. Well, there's only two religions. I really come down to the point there's only two religions in all the world. I know there's thousands and thousands, but there's only two. One is that Christ did everything for you and nothing else is required. And the other is you must do something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so whether you're talking on various cults or you're talking about the various forms of Hinduism, of Buddhism, or Islam, or Native American religions, traditional religions, animism, all those require something of you. They all require your work, your sacrifice. And there's only Christ out there. So when we engage in these things, we're purposely putting ourselves really in. It's not different than if we're going to Africa and involving ourselves in some type of a spiritual movement, or going to Haiti and worshiping with the voodoo priests. Mm-hmm. It's really not that different. I know that's somewhat unpolitically correct, but if you view the world in those two frames, it really becomes much easier.
Yeah, it's either Christ or Christ plus or not
right.
Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And the Christ plus could be anything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You describe a trip to New Orleans,
right.
And you're surprised at finding outside the big cathedral there a scene that reminded me of the money changers in the temple that mm-hmm. Jesus drove out, people setting up their card tables right outside a cathedral built for the glory of God and Jesus Christ, manned by people who were there to tell fortunes and hold seances and things. What was that about, and what kind of people were giving them business?
Well, that was interesting. I knew when I was writing this book that I had to go look at something that was in your face in an American culture, and what better place to go find that than New Orleans?
Yeah. Sure.
And so I took another pastor friend with me, and I said, hey, we're going to go to New Orleans, but we're going on the spiritual trip. You know, most people are there, they're engaging in other activities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But what we did is we went to various voodoo shops, to various voodoo temples, and then just kind of looked at the general spiritual circumstances of the area. And that was one of them. Right away from basically dusk to dawn, there's multiple tables set up in front of the cathedral there with different types of mediums. And the interesting thing is, if you look at who's at these tables, it could be any of our neighbors. People there with their little children getting their readings done, older people, younger people, all the tourists. Now, I would expect that most of the tourists there are probably thinking, well, this is just fun and this is part of the culture of New Orleans or mm-hmm. something like that. Those people who aren't Christian maybe, or some Christians too. And so they engage in these things. Mm. But when we look at a medium and we look at these type of individuals, there's a lot of them out there are just putting on a show.
Yeah.
They really don't have any real abilities. They're not getting messages from the other side. But there's other ones out there that are. And sometimes even the ones that are putting on a show, the demons will use them to lead people down the wrong road. So, I mean, the scripture is really clear on these things. We are not to be necromancers. The Old Testament is very strong in this. Mm-hmm. And what that means is we're not to seek advice from the dead. I mean, this is something the Lord clearly is against. Now, if you're not a Christian, maybe you don't have a problem with that. But for us Christians, engaging in the medium in the Old Testament would have got us killed.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, so a very difficult situation.
You described a trip through a voodoo temple in New Orleans. Again, what was that like, and what kind of people were going and seeking it? What were they seeking in that temple?
Yeah, the people, like I said, it was just general people who are going to New Orleans or living in that area. They would be just like any of our neighbors or anything like that as far as their appearance. But for instance, in the voodoo temple, the front of the location is just a bookstore. Really not a very fancy bookstore either. You can find much better ones if you go downtown and into the real voodoo areas. But it turns out there's a voodoo temple, and if you get access from the voodoo priestess there, you can go back in and go into the temple itself. And, you know, I used to always watch cartoons when I was a kid, right? And so you'd have the different cartoon figure, and you'd have the genie, and you'd have the cave with all the money in it and stuff, and you get inside the cave. Literally, this is what this was like. I've got pictures of it in the book. Just walls full of money. And all these various deities, whether it be voodoo deities or Roman Catholic, I mean, almost every religious possibility you could imagine was in this room, a very syncretistic location. And then you would go and give money and then write your prayer request or whatever and leave it at the base of the different deities in this place. And there must have been thousands upon thousands of dollars on there. You wonder why, you think they would need security or something.
Yeah.
And so I've got a number of those pictures. I put those in the book just so people would actually see that, that this is a reality. So when I'm in there, there's this young couple, and I don't think they're married. They're probably just dating or something like that. And I saw them in there. They were giving a gift of money to one of the idols in there, and writing I'm expecting it was probably something to do with their relationship or whatever, and dropped their money. I think they dropped a $20 bill in there and with their piece of paper and walked out. And to them, they just had done a good deed. Well, it was interesting. I talked to the one who was running the place, and I said, well, this is what's going on back there. This is really just various forms of voodoo and animistic worship, and I even actually named some of the voodoo gods that were in there. And her response was, "Be quiet! Don't tell anybody that, because if they know that, they won't come here."
Oh my goodness!
Her point was all religions are the same, and the Native American shaman made the same point, and generally they do. All religions are the same; it doesn't matter, and so people would go there. I don't know what she did with the money. I think she just left it there. She probably believed it too, because it was so much money there that it was crazy.
That's astonishing.
They had one fish tank full of dollar bills and $5 bills and stuff with a mermaid in it, an idol of a mermaid, because in African religions, that's supposed to be one of the most powerful of the spirits. And it's not the happy mermaid that Disney has either. So it's quite an interesting place.
Yeah, I remember you mentioned a story about a gentleman who was oppressed by one of these water spirits in the first book. For Christians who are coming at this from the typical Western or American worldview, that this is the kind of thing that only happens among superstitious people who aren't educated as we are here in the West, what do you hope that they take away from reading your books?
I hope they simply start to recognize that this is a reality. The main world, the non-Christian out there, that's a different thing. They're, most of them already believe in these things. They don't believe in God. They don't believe in Jesus as their Savior, but they do believe in these spiritual realities. My real audience is I'm hoping to reach Christians who, first off, are trying to make sense out of what's going on in their lives, to recognize some of these dangerous things. The one thing we didn't talk about in the book, there's a whole section on a psychic expo. Where the people are in there, they're all in there seeing their mediums and watching these various speakers, and it's like going to the mall. I mean, literally, go to your local mall, look who's at your mall, and go in the psychic expo, and that's the people who are in there. So I'm just trying to get people to recognize the realities that are here, that this is a reality. Satan is this roaring lion seeking to devour us, and we have answers for things. That's why, the first book is I Am Not Afraid, and the second book is Afraid, and I was doing that to keep the combination between the two, but as you read the stories, you find out really there's nothing to be afraid of. Indeed, Satan is a defeated foe. He has been defeated in the cross. John chapter 12 makes that very, very clear. But yet he still likes to pretend as if he's not. And if he can make us think that he's in control, even if he's not, he's in control. An example I use is if I show up to repossess your car and I have a piece of paper in my hand and you give me the car, even if it was all a scam, I've got your car.
Right.
And the same thing happens with individuals. They fall for these lies. When if they simply understood what was happening, they wouldn't fall for the lies. If they knew who they were in Jesus, they would be okay.
So is it possible for a Christian to fall for the lie?
Oh, yeah, that happens constantly. Christians are always falling for the lie, even your most devoted Christians. We always find ourselves, even in our own mind, falling for the lies of who we are, right?
And can we then be spiritually possessed?
Can a Christian be spiritually possessed? No, this is a difficult answer. I think most people would say no. And I think there's a good biblical argument to be made for that. However, the scripture doesn't say that a Christian can't be possessed. And from the history of the church, we found many professing Christians who also were possessed. Mm-hmm. So what do you do with these two things? I think there's a great danger in saying that a Christian cannot be possessed, even though I think it would be very rare, and if it happened, it would be for whatever God's purposes. But the danger is this. If you say a Christian cannot be possessed, but someone is living their life as a Christian, they're faithfully attending church, they're confessing the faith as if any of us would, and then this was to happen to them, now you're left with a difficulty. Now you must say, well, obviously they must not have been a Christian anyways, which I think is an absolute horrible thing for us to do. And so from our Lutheran tradition and our history, we've recognized that this is a possibility, and it's something that's dealt with through the same way that we talked earlier, through simply the preaching of the word, the command from the Lord to depart, and that's how we deal with the circumstances.
There's a wonderful scripture where Jesus talks about a house that's swept clean.
Yeah, I use that a number of times in the book.
But you have to fill that empty house with the Lord, with the Holy Spirit.
Well, you know, it's the same thing for the life of the Christian. We can be Christians, we hold strong to our faith, and yet as we maybe stop praying as much because we're busy, before we know it, 6 months down the road, we say, I haven't prayed in the last 2 or 3 months. Or those who attend church, you get tired, it's busy, it's who wants to get up on a Sunday morning or whatever and go to church. And so I'm going to skip this week. And before you know it, I haven't been there in 6 months. And then it's really hard to go back when you've been gone for that long.
Because you don't want to answer the questions, right. Where you been?
Yeah. Or you start saying for prayer. Well, maybe I shouldn't pray because God won't listen to me because I haven't prayed, which is a complete and utter lie.
Oh, yeah.
But these are the lies that we tell ourselves.
And the lies coming from the enemy that lead us down the wrong path.
Well,
again, we want you to have these books as reference materials and perhaps as materials to share with friends or even pastors to document the reality of demon possession, but also the power in Jesus Christ to free us from that possession. The first book, I Am Not Afraid, Demon Possession and Spiritual Warfare. The new book, Afraid, Demon Possession and Spiritual Warfare in America. Both books together, $39.99 plus shipping and handling. But when you buy those books from Skywatch TV, we will add the book, The Supernatural Worldview by Chris Putnam. And Chris, in this book, cites I Am Not Afraid as a source material for making his case in this book. So we'll add this one to you for free. Three excellent books for your reference library from Skywatch TV, $39.99 plus shipping and handling. You'll find that deal online at skywatchtvstore.com. Time for one final thought with about 30 seconds.
Sure.
Again, the overriding message regarding spiritual warfare that you'd like to pass on to viewers.
The overriding message is very simple and it's very clear. Christ has defeated Satan. There's nothing for us to fear if we're in him. We who are in him, we need to remember that to avoid the lies that come our way. We who aren't in him, the Lord sometimes uses these difficulties in our lives to make us realize that we can't do anything on our own, but he's always there waiting to care for us and to love us, for he's already died for us.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, we thank you for watching as we keep watch. For Sharon Gilbert, I'm Derek Gilbert, and this is Skywatch TV.